Welcome to the 2017 Wisconsin Film Festival and Nick Offerman Day. The festival is co-presented by the University of Wisconsin's Arts Institute and Department of Communication Arts. And this screening of Look and See is presented with the support from the Department of Community and Environmental Sociology and Wisconsin Public Radio. So let's hear a hand for our supporters, please. Thank you. It is my pleasure now to turn the mic over to the executive producer of Wisconsin Public Radio's To the Best of Our Knowledge, Mr. Steve Paulson. Please welcome Steve.
Thank you, Jim, and you are in for a treat here. I just saw the film the other night, and it is wonderful. It's a great pleasure to be here to introduce Nick Offerman, one of the co-producers of the film you're about to see. And I think you all know that Nick is a man of many talents, humorist, actor, and as you know from his role from Parks and Recreation, master woodworker. He is a craftsman in the best sense. And we're about to see a film that celebrates the art of craftsmanship, as well as honest living and stewardship of the land, and a lot of values that we might think are kind of old-fashioned, but maybe we need to hang on to a little bit more than we realize. Nick has a very personal connection to the subject of this film, Wendell Berry. He's been a fan for many years, and I'm sure we'll be able to talk a little bit later about that personal connection. We will, by the way, after the film, we'll have a Q&A. So stick around, don't run out, and you'll get a bit of the backstory of the film. So without further ado, please help me welcome Nick Offerman.
Thank you very kindly. Good afternoon. I'm very grateful to see you all. This is very moving. Wendell Berry is my favorite writer. I think his writing should be required for all of us to read, and we'd have a lot less assholes to deal with. including this one. I'm incredibly grateful and honored to be part of this film. It's beautiful, and it was crafted through the hard work of many people, none of whom were me. I am very lucky to be a cheerleader and fundraiser and supporter of the film, but Laura Dunn, the filmmaker, and her co-director husband, Jeff Sewell, are about to deliver a very great treat to you. I'd start doing some deep breathing right now, because this film is poetry, and it'll tickle you in the good spot. We'll talk a lot more about it afterwards if you make it through, and if not, I wish you well. Thank you. Wow, you stayed.
Great to see all of you. Now, Nick, people may not realize that you actually made an appearance in this film.
Partially. When they were in post and Laura was editing it, there's that real nice thing Wendell says about people who make things and our propensity to see two things we think ought to go together and put them together, whether they're making a stew or musical composition or writing a novel. And she said, I think it would be nice if you would make a stool and we'll shoot it. So they shot just my hands and tools making a three-legged stool, which I call the Berry Stool. It's also featured in my book, Good Clean Fun. You can learn how to make one of your very own. But yeah, because my face is not seen, I believe that is the peak of my career.
Now, speaking of faces not being seen, it's a bit of a trick to make a documentary about someone whose face never appears, except for in this old archival footage. Why don't we see Wendell Berry in this film?
Well, Wendell, he doesn't like his work or his life or himself to be interpreted really in any way, if possible, other than the written word. And so it took Laura a long time to convince Wendell and Tanya to agree to this film. And one of the caveats was that Wendell would not appear on screen. And also that sort of shifted the focus from the story of Wendell Berry to the story of what Wendell Berry would perhaps want a film to be about. And so it went from him to sort of his mission or his message. And by doing that they then agreed to it. And Laura, the filmmaker, I think, kind of enjoyed that particular batch of lemons and said, oh, I think I can make some decent lemonade out of this.
Now, it's worth pointing out that Wendell Berry is a bit of a Luddite, I think it's fair to say.
I think he would accept that.
And in fact, I should mention that Nick and I did an interview for my radio show earlier today, and so I got a bit of the backstory here. And in fact, you will hear that interview on our podcast on To the Best of Our Knowledge later this week.
It's fine work.
And one of the things that you mentioned is that Wendell doesn't have any screens in his house. In other words, he would not be able to see this movie.
Yeah, that's true. I don't believe he's seen it quite yet. We've sent him a Blu-ray player and a DVD, which he's going to have to go to a neighbor's house and get that hooked up to a screen implement. But we talked about he wrote a famous essay that they published, I think, in Harper's in the 90s called Why I Don't Have a Computer by Wendell Berry. And he talked about it and said that, you know, he doesn't like to view the world through a screen of any sort. He loves the world. He wants to be out in it where he can hear it and smell it and see it. And in that essay, he actually starts off by kind of espousing the dangers of electrical wire. Like, but he's right. You know, what he's preaching, as soon as you run a wire to your house, then you're complicit. You know, then you're on the grid. And if you're going to gripe about what we're doing in the Middle East, well, then you have to be ready to explain the wire running to your house. And so he has gone that far. They do have a telephone and electricity, but that's something that I really appreciate, and that I think Laura gently takes that attitude of his and says, okay, that's what we love about you, but most of the rest of the people are okay with screens to some extent. So how can we take your package and interpret it through this frame?
Now, it would seem that there are some ironies in terms of your involvement in this. You make a living in front of screens.
I do.
You are a humorist, and Wendell Berry seems to be a pretty serious guy.
Oh, no, he's not.
No?
No, I mean, he's dead serious, but he's like a philosopher king. He will, you know, he'll lecture for an hour about what kind of tires you should put on your truck, but he loves nothing more than to laugh, and he's a lover of life, and he's very joyful. So, you know, anything from a mosquito bite to a great piece of humor will make him laugh long and hard.
So how did you first discover Wendell Berry? How far back does it go?
About 22 years or so. I was doing Buried Child, a Sam Shepard play, at Steppenwolf Theater in Chicago, and a great actor named Leo Burmester gave me some Wendell Berry short stories. Leo was also a former laborer and dipshit. We were kindred spirits, and he gave me these stories and said, I mean, he knew what he was doing. He said, I think you're going to get a kick out of this, and I just was besotted immediately. It changed my life, and I immediately started writing to Wendell, asking him if I could adapt his stories, which he was not agreeable to. He doesn't want to see his work adapted in his lifetime. And I continued corresponding with him, and it took me through this movie and a book I was working on. I finally met him. So I guess it took me almost 20 years to meet him.
Before he would consent.
Yes.
To meet.
He had to be sure of my fidelity.
So you've read a bunch of his books, right?
Yeah, I believe I've read all of them, although
that's a lot of books.
It is a lot of books, but I look forward to many of them. I've read more than once. His fiction is, I guess, because of my own proclivities, I'm just besotted with his fiction. I love a series of books. You know, if you read a good piece of fiction, it's such a wonderful escape and a delight in so many ways. And then if that writer has done you the great service of continuing that world across Madeline L'Engle's, you know, five books, or Little House on the Prairie, or the Patrick O'Brien books, the Hornblower books, the Lord of the Rings, all that stuff. Wendell Berry, you know, takes the Chronicles of Narnia and sets it on a Kentucky farm. And that's the great thing. His many works of fiction, short stories and novels, are all filling in the same vast mural of, you know, several decades of three main families in this farming community. But his essays, too, I'm quite taken with. His last book of essays, called Our Only World, at the age of like 80, he wrote this essay called, it's something like On the Fence or Caught in Between, something like that. And in the essay, he talks himself from being a biblical pro-lifer. He logics it out, and by the end of the essay, he's pro-choice. And I was so moved by that at his age, that he was still open to his own, that he's still trying to figure it out. And he said, you know, there are very good reasons for both of these stances, but at the end of the day, to be simply fair in a human way, I have to say we should never legislate on somebody's ability to make this decision. And I just, you know, I continue to be a great disciple of his work that way.
So you've said he's your favorite writer.
Yeah.
In fact, in our interview, you said he's your Shakespeare.
Sure, yeah.
What is it about his voice as a writer that you respond to so much?
Oh, boy. Well, I mean, you know, I feel cowed by that question because I'm not as good with words as he is. But all of the general things, you know, there's Shakespeare comes to mind, Mark Twain, you know, where he has such a great, honest take on the human animal, which means he writes tragedy and comedy with equal pathos. And another favorite writer, George Saunders, is doing it really well right now, where, you know, you fall in love with the humanity of his characters, whether they're incredibly flawed or beautiful and saintly, or usually somewhere in between. He also has a terrific sense of humor. I mean, a gut-busting sense of humor. But the thing that really moved me was the respect and reverence that he pays to simple hard work, and how, you know, truly in a reverential, almost holy way, he imparts the idea that the secret to life is having good hard work to do. And if you know, it doesn't matter how simple it is. I mean, he's usually talking about some sort of farming. And in his lifetime, he saw farming go from being the life's blood of so many American communities to be considered more, you know, everybody began moving to the urban centers after the Industrial Revolution, and farmers began to be considered hayseeds and rubes. And, you know, he talks about how it's a little nowhere place out in the middle of nowhere. And so that's part of what he's reacting against. He's saying, actually, you wouldn't believe how incredibly rich and intelligent and clever these communities of people are. And that's the kind of community I grew up in.
You grew up in a farming community?
Yeah, a little farm town called Minooka, Illinois, which is just right next to Shanahan. That's my dad's joke, and he's here. Just southwest of Joliet, and like my mom and dad grew up a couple miles from each other on farms. I went to my junior high was their high school. It was that kind of little town, and I have this great family. We had a bunch of them over last night. Everybody in my family is school teacher, nurse, paramedic, librarian. There's a brewer of beer, and he's the king of the family. But I mean, the entire family, with the exception of me, the black sheep, are public servants, and they're just the greatest people who also understand how rich your life can be if you're frugal and you make things for yourselves, so that you don't spend your time shopping. You spend your time having dinner with your family, and you know, generally that results in a better set of values, a better work ethic, and I've certainly profited massively by being a member of my family, and that keeps me very grateful and humble, because they're, you know, in and amongst my family are smarter people, funnier people, kinder people, harder working people. I'm maybe the tallest. That's my distinction, and I'll stand by it.
Well, you have such an interesting background. Of course, you know, most of us know you from your work on screens as an actor. You're also a woodworker. You have a wood shop in L.A. You've got a team of people who make fine tables and chairs and stools. And I know you're a boat builder, among other things. Is there any connection between these two things, what you do as an actor and this working with your hands with wood?
Well, I guess a tangential connection. I mean, When I went to theater school in Champaign-Urbana, I was very bad at acting, and I learned, you know, once I looked around, I learned that I was really lucky to get into the program, because it was a conservatory program, and I figured out, I was like, man, why'd you put me in this program if you're not going to cast me? And they cast the attractive people and the talented people, but every year they'd bring in a couple people to carry those actors on and off stage, and that I was quite good at. And I learned while I was there that I could build scenery. I had tool skills that my dad taught me, and that was a revelation, because it allowed me to be valuable to this community. I made money, and I could build all of our stuff. So they would give me a few lines in the show, and then I'd build the set. And so eventually, the two just continued to dovetail, where I would supplement one income. Sometimes I would be successful doing plays in Chicago. Sometimes I would have to lean on my scenery income. So by the time I moved to Los Angeles, I was, you know, a pretty decent guy in a shop full of tools, and also could get an acting job here and there. And so they just were all part of my creative persona. But once I got to Hollywood itself, it is as sort of gross and superficial as you've heard, and I kind of quickly reacted in a defensive way and said, okay, I'm not going to pursue all these avenues, you know, that people tell me to, that, you know, the business tells you to. Instead, I'm going to work as a carpenter, and they have my number. If they want me to be on their show, they'll call me. And that was a great, you know, all of that has to do with my family. Like, despite myself, my parents' common sense kept sneaking through. And you know, eventually people began to value that and say, hey, that's kind of neat that you're off making tables instead of sitting at the coffee shop or in step aerobics class. And so even to this day, I certainly don't, you know, I've gotten really lucky to where I'm making a nice living as an entertainer. I don't need to have my wood shop, but I tenaciously cling to it because, among other things, it continues to connect me to my family and that sensibility of, well, I could buy a yacht and go hang out on it and listen to rap music, but I think that that's what assholes do. So I'm just going to keep making stuff here in my shop because that seems to be pleasing to people, and I don't think I'll please anybody, As terrific as I understand Drake records are, they're maybe not for me.
I am willing to bet that there are some questions from our audience. So why don't you raise your hand and I will call on you. Let's go back there.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. Let me just repeat that. Enjoying or wondering about the distribution of the movie, also enjoying audiobook of Lincoln on the Bardo by George Saunders, which I happen to know is an audiobook that you were one of the readers on, and there are 166 actors, I know.
That's correct. 166 voices on that audiobook. An incredible list of actors. George Saunders is a very popular short story writer, and this is his first novel. And the list of talent on the audiobook is ridiculous, and as long as my arm, and I also appear on the audiobook. And to answer your first question, the filmmaker, Laura, you know, has really gotten caught up and kind of obsessed with not only Wendell's vision, but his daughter, Mary, now runs the Barry Center in Newcastle, Kentucky. And it's basically a little library-ish outfit that uses the writings of Wendell and his brother and his dad, all brilliant agriculture-forward writers. They used to be associated with a college in Kentucky that I want to say is called St. Catherine's that, like, closed. So they're kind of looking for a home, but in that effort, Laura is trying to take the film first to agriculture colleges. Like, she wants to show it on the wall of tobacco barns a lot more before it, because playing the art house is nice, but she really wants to take it to the towns where the movie is talking about. And so she's trying to do that as much as possible. We're putting together funding for a sort of, you know, farmer tour of sorts. And then it should generally, you know, it may well come to colleges and art houses, but then it, certainly probably by the end of the year, it'll show up on Discovery or National Geographic or something like that.
And it's worth pointing out that the two executive producers of this film are Terrence Malick and Robert Redford, and you told me a very funny Robert Redford story.
I did. It was funny. So Wendell sort of became much more known in the mid to late 70s with a book of essays called The Unsettling of America. That he sort of blew up, certainly in the world of agrarianism and conservation-minded folks. And one of the people that took notice was Robert Redford. And so one day in the Barry household, the phone rang. And Tanya answered it, and Tanya had been to the movie theater, and she was kind of shaking and said, "Wendell, it's for you." And Wendell said, "Hello? Yes? Well, thank you very much. No, thank you, I'm not interested. No thanks. Have a good day." Hung up. And then he turned to her and said, "Who the hell is Robert Redstone?" And she was mortified, but then eventually vindicated. This January, we played this at Sundance, and Bob introduced the film, and so she finally got to have her Robert Redford moment. And he wanted to get his picture taken with her, but I made sure that I was also in all the pictures so that Wendell wouldn't feel that we didn't have his back.
Let's go right there.
The question is, considering what's talked about in the film, putting two things back together, do we have time, or is it too late for modern agriculture and the food economy to be saved? I don't know. That's a huge question, and that's certainly what we're afraid of. But, you know, the way things are going right now in our country, I don't know if you've heard much about politics, but you know, at the moment, there's a lot of darkness happening, but in a way, I find it very enervating because I feel like I'm as guilty as anybody of kind of falling asleep at the wheel, like, oh, you know, gay people can get married now. Let's go to the movies and take a break. And we've come to this place where we're like, oh, shoot, we need to pay a lot more attention. There's a few more things to accomplish. And so I feel like that's exciting. I feel like things are going to be lousy here for a minute, but then, you know, we're going to take two steps back, and then we're going to actually find a stepladder and climb even perhaps to a slightly better evolution. I don't know. Human beings are very lazy. I count myself among us, if you'll have me. And so it's a tough question, you know. A lot of us have the sensibility of recognizing that our natural resources do have a limit, and, you know, and that we are using them up in many ways. It seems to me that so far the human race won't really make a change for the better, like you're talking about, until until the lights go out. And then you know, and then once we then we'll burn all the candles, and they'll be like, ah, shit, Al Gore was right.
I'm glad they didn't interview you for this.
Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I am as ignorant as the next person, and so I, you know, my family are amazing gardeners, and so I know that's a good idea. So I tell others my gardening's terrific. It's quite inexpensive, and you get really fresh produce. And so that's why I'm invested in kind of trying to help. If my job was just preaching Wendell Berry to the rest of the world for the rest of my career, I think I had the luckiest job. But you know, one of my catchphrases is "Us dipshits got to stick together." And that's what I mean. It's, you know, those of us that understand that it's just as rewarding to dig a good post hole as it is to drive a BMW. Those are our people, and you know, hopefully enough of us will vote eventually to get some gardens going again.
Let's go right here.
Well, the question is specifically, what am I hearing from the tobacco folks? Because it's a very interesting point that the agriculture, the main agriculture this focuses on, and that area made their living on is tobacco, which is obviously a polarizing crop. I'm very ignorant to tobacco farming in general, other than what I've read. But I have read a lot about it, mainly in Barry's work, and I've heard them talk about it a lot since I've been around their family, and it is it actually was a great difficulty for our film, because Sundance is so progressive and green-minded, you know, that even they couldn't see past the tobacco to see the crisis of these people, because they're white people. And because they're growing tobacco, so they're like, no, we've got these homeless kids in Syria. Like we have seven of those movies that have to come before this movie. It's certainly in this country, tobacco is really taking a hit in general, because our health awareness is getting out in front of it enough. I mean, it's insane to imagine the first flight I ever took. Commercially was Chicago to Tokyo, because I was doing a play. And imagine the size of this Airbus going to Tokyo, and that's when they still had a smoking section. It would be like if I said, okay, everybody on this side can smoke. That was what it was like on the plane. We were that dumb that recently. But the rest of the world is still a huge market for tobacco, and there's, you know, and we're still not very loudly, but selling them as much of it as we possibly can. However, in areas like this where tobacco was the main crop, the states have taken enough of a hit that I'm given to understand a lot of them are having to switch over to either row crops or these kind of large vegetable operations, which is another difficulty because part of the reason it was ideal for tobacco was because of the hilly land. There wasn't a lot of flat, easily machined land. So now they're turning more hills into flat, which is terrible for erosion. You lose the topsoil. So, you know, you're damned if you do and damned if you don't. But to my understanding, tobacco is only shrinking and shrinking in most of these places where it used to be the bread and butter.
We have just a couple of minutes left. Wendell Berry is, what, 81 years old now?
Yeah, it might be 82 now.
82. Yeah. Is he still an active writer, active doing his farming?
Well, the first time I went there, they served me lamb for lunch, and it was one of their lambs. And everything was from their garden or from their barn, and it was incredible and delicious and fresh. And then the next time I visited was in the spring, and he took me down to the barn to play with the new lambs. And it was pretty moving. I mean, I grew up in the country, and my grandparents had pigs, and I'd been around livestock some. But as an adult, and I've been pretty urban for a while, that was pretty moving and viscerally real, you know, to sort of suddenly be inside one of his books and caper about the corral with next year's lunch had an effect on me. You know, he's not getting around like he used to, so he's certainly not out in the field anymore, but he still maintains animals, and mainly he's still writing. You know, the older he gets, the more his legend grows, people want him to travel around and lecture, and they give him awards and stuff. But he doesn't like to travel that much. I think he spends most of his energy. He continues to write. There's a book of essays coming out that are some older ones and some new ones. So he's still plugging away, and I hope he keeps at it.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you all so much.